We are live. Everybody.
Church. So I know this is a new experience for us as we're doing our first Facebook live stream, but we want it to be as safe as possible in this season and make sure we're as prepared as possible for this situation and treating it in the right way. So before we get started, I want us to think about three things this morning. The first thing is let us trust God in this season. This is a temporary season. This will pass. We know that we can trust God with anything. We want to trust him in this season. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says this: God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. So we're not afraid, we're not concerned, but we trust God, and we operate in wisdom as we trust him for this situation. The second thing I want to remind you this morning is that this is a time where we can love our neighbors, making sure that we're doing the right things, being safe, so that we can take care of those around us who are the most vulnerable. So let's take this time to love our neighbors in this season as well. And lastly, and most importantly, let's make sure that we are praying. We need to pray because we need God's power, we need his grace, we need him to move in this situation, and we need him to give us wisdom and how to move. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says this: be anxious for nothing, but with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. So we're going to go before him not worried, but we're going before him with our prayers and our concerns, asking him to guide us and direct us in this season. So we're going to get started with our worship. We're excited for you to join us this morning.
Good morning, those that are watching. This is a new experience for me as well. But, you know, one thing we can all sympathize with in this season, but we always experience seasons of ups and downs. It's not just during a time like this. We can always remember that the world may try to drag us down. Such circumstances, life events may try to drag us down, but we're always alive in our God. We're always alive in the power of Jesus Christ. And the world can never drown that out, no matter what happens. So let's sing Alive in You.
Thank you.
worship with no congregation. And then I remembered that worship, you know, is not about the congregation, and that our audience is always one. And then in that regard, there's absolutely no difference between today and any other day. We're worshiping the same God, and we have one person that we're worshiping to. So even though it's a little different looking out there and not seeing you all this morning, I'm just so glad that we're still here to worship the one person we were meant to. So let's please sing, O Church Arise.
Oh, expenses need to be paid. There's some ways you can do that. Mail them your offering in. The office will be open this week, Monday through Thursday, if you'd like to stop by. Or you can go to the website, the church website, and click on the link for online giving. We want to encourage you to continue to support our church. The expenses still need to be paid. So keep that in mind. If you would, join me in prayer now as we go to the Lord and thank Him for all that He's given us and ask Him to bless our offerings that we're going to give back to Him. So, shall we pray? Father God, we come before Your throne of grace this morning with humble hearts. Yet we come confidently, Lord, knowing that You love us, that You care about the situations we're in. You're involved in our lives. Father, we know that compared to Calvary, anything that we can do or give is insufficient. But Father, we ask that You would take our offerings and multiply them as only You can. Use them to further Your kingdom, both here in Middle River, throughout the world. Father, again, we simply say thank You for who You are, for Your love for us, knowing that You want the very best for us. Father, we ask all these things in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. In His name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
God's in control, God's sovereign, and he knows what he's doing. So let's go to God in prayer as we get started this morning. Eternal God, Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for everything, Lord. Lord, what's going on now, it didn't catch you by surprise. You knew this would happen. But Lord, right now we come to you. We trust you on what you're going to do. Father God, I pray for those who are sick, that you would heal them, that you would touch them, Lord. I pray for those who are trying to stay healthy, Lord, that you be with them as well. And God, I just pray, Lord, that this gives us an opportunity to come to you, Lord. Just pour our hearts out to you, Lord. So God, we just also pray as we get ready to go into your word this morning that you would speak to me by the power of your Holy Spirit. Touch and change lives for your glory. May I decrease, may you increase. May your son Jesus be lifted up this morning. Give us a word from on high as we look to move forward in this world. In light of all that's going on, to be a light in a dark place. Help today, Lord Jesus. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning to you again. It's good to be here. Those of you watching online, those of you here live, it's good to be here. And our sermon this morning will come from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. I'll be reading from the ESV translation. The author of Hebrews writes, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." Verse 2, "Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." This morning I want to talk from the subject, persevering in faith. Oh, I have in parentheses, no pain, no pain, no pain. I know it's the saying, no pain, no gain, but I'm going somewhere with this no pain. The story is told of an evangelist who had two set of pups in his backyard where he trained them. In his backyard one day, as the evangelist was looking out the window, he saw his two set of pups back there, these top-notch bird dogs. And late one day, he saw this bulldog walking down the alley. And as the bulldog walked down the aisle, he stopped at his backyard's fence. And the bulldog began to look at the backyard. He saw the dogs, but he looked in the backyard. The bulldog wanted to be in his backyard. So the bulldog crawled underneath the fence, went into the backyard, and as he went underneath the backyard to the backyard, from the fence to the backyard, these two set of pups went at him right away. These dogs began to fight. They went round for round for round for round. And each round, the two set of pups wore the bulldog out. When the bulldog had enough, he turned around, he stopped at the fence, he crawled underneath the fence, went back into the alley, and went on his way. The next day came. Guess who we see coming down the alley? The bulldog. He's strolling down the alley. He stops at the backyard, he stops at the fence, he crawls underneath the fence into the backyard, and the two set of pups jump on him right away. They wore him out. Round for round for round for round. When the bulldog had enough, he turned around, crawled underneath the fence, and he went on his merry way down the alley. This happened for several weeks. Several weeks, the bulldog would come down the alley. He would look in the backyard. He wanted to be in the backyard. And then he crawls underneath the fence into the backyard, and they wear him out. But then one day came, the bulldog, same routine, he stops. At the backyard, at the fence, he crawls beneath the fence into the backyard. But this time, the set of pups run away. They're whining and crying. They're whining and crying. And the evangelist couldn't believe what was going on because he thought he was teaching the bulldog a lesson by allowing the two set of pups to beat up the bulldog. But this time, his set of pups are running and whining and crying with the bulldog. This bulldog wanted the backyard. He wanted to be in the backyard. And just as his bulldog was willing to persevere in order to obtain his backyard, God has called us, the people of God, to persevere in order to obtain a heavenly promise. Every day we go through something. We go round for round for round for round. And we feel like they're getting the best of us. We feel like the world is getting the best of us. But then each day we go home, we pray, we read, we study, we meditate, and we get encouragement. We come back to church. They get encouragement to go back the next week. Again and again and again. This morning I titled this message, persevering in the faith. This morning, I have 2 points for this morning. And before I get this text, you got to understand what's going on here contextually wise. The author of Hebrews is writing to a group of people who are being persecuted. You have these Jewish Christians who are here. They're being persecuted. They once believed the way to God was through practicing the law. It was through the law. But then this guy named Jesus comes on earth. And he begins to talk about, unless you drink his blood and eat his body, you have no part with him. He begins to talk about this thing of grace alone, faith alone, and Christ alone. He begins to say, I am the light of the world. He begins to teach, I am the bread of life. He begins to teach, I am the good shepherd. And they had these memories of this man with these teachings. And they said, we trust in Christ. We believe that the law, it pretty much talked about Christ, but Christ came to fulfill the law. So these Jewish Christians are saying, it's a new thing. Is that the law, it just pretty much laid the foundation to help Christ come and fulfill it. And so you had some other Jews that said, we don't like this. We don't like this talking about you talking about this man Jesus, that he's the bread of life. We don't like this stuff that you're saying, how Jesus has changed your life. You got to stop talking about this. And what you have was a lot of persecution among family members and friends being persecuted because of what was going on. And it got to the point that some people said, I love Jesus, but I don't love him that much. I'm going to leave Christianity, this new thing, and I'm going back to Judaism. And this was going on, and so with the author of Hebrews, he was aware of this. He begins to write this letter to encourage the Christians to hang in there. He begins to walk around the book of Hebrews about how Christ, you have the Old Testament, you have the priests, you have the prophets, and he begins to teach how Christ fulfilled that, how Christ is our high priest. He begins to talk about how the Old Testament system was not adequate enough since Christ came and fulfilled it. He is the final sacrifice. Throughout the book of Hebrews, the author pretty much argues this. Some say the book of Hebrews was written by Paul. Some say it was not written by Paul. I believe it was not written by Paul because if you look at the Greek text, you see that the same way that Paul writes his Pauline epistles are different from the book of Hebrews. But whatever you stand on, whatever side you stand on, that's fine with me. But my whole point, the author of Hebrews, he's writing to encourage these believers who feel like giving up. They feel like quitting because it's getting hard. It's getting tough. This past season, I coached basketball. I coached the middle school B team. And I had the B team. Not the A team. I had the B team. And so with the B team, I had to deal with teaching fundamentals. I had to teach them how to catch the ball, how to get a triple threat, how to shoot free throws, how to make layups. We couldn't make layups. And we had like 9 games. And guess how many we won? 1 game. We lost 8 games at the beginning of the season, and it was bad. It was bad. It got to the point that I got frustrated. And I said, you know what? One time we lost like our 7th game or 8th game. I said, you know what? No practice. This is what we're going to do. We're going to hang out. We're going to go to Chick-fil-A. We're going to bond with each other. We're going to try to enjoy our time together. And we're going to watch the A team play a game. And you know, that was one of the best times we had together. We sat down, we ate a meal together, we watched a game together, we talked together, we rode the bus together, but it was a really good church of time because I felt like quitting. I was like, this is bad on my culture record. This is bad on my resume. But I said, you know what? It really wasn't about the culture, the wins and losses. It was about mentoring and spending time with these young men. It was really time to be with them, to tell them, this is what you do when you want to hang your head. This is what happens when you want to quit. This is what you want to do. And so when we look at our text this morning, the author of Hebrews is writing to his audience to say, hang in there. Don't quit. Hang in there. Hang in there. The reason why this passage is so important because the enemy would love for us to quit. He would love for us to throw in the towel. He would love to see someone who's walking with the Lord Jesus Christ to say, you know what, this is too much for me. I quit. He would love to see some members of Middle River Baptist Church to quit. He would love for people to say, you know what? I want to quit on my marriage. I want to quit on my kid. He would love to see people throw in the towel and turn away. But he says, no. You got to hang in there. You got to hang in there. And he says, you need to hang in there because there's something greater than you. He says, the church of God that was talking about Matthew chapter 16, it is bigger than you. It goes beyond you, so you must hang in there. The word perseverance is defined as steadfastness, constancy, endurance. It's It's like a man that's not swerved at all. He's just hanging in there. He's at one particular purpose. He's going straight ahead. He's not going back and forth, but he's determined that he will stand on this regardless of what comes his way. One person said this about perseverance. He says, to persevere is to cultivate the attitude that somehow, some way, you will get through the tough times and get to a better place in your life. There was one cartoon caption. It had a frog. It was on his rope. And he was hanging onto the rope. And the caption read, when you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot at the end of it and hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. That's what God has called us to do, especially in times like this. He's called us to hold on. He's called us to love our neighbors. He's called us to be a light in the dark place. He's called us to do that where we are, because we never know who's watching. We never know who's being ministered to from a distance. We never know who's wondering, like, I wonder if this Christian stuff is real with this person, because when the tough times come, we can see whether he quits or she quits or she hangs in there. Winston Churchill, at an address at Harvard School, October 29, 1941, writes, never give in. Never give in. Never, never, never in nothing, great or small, large or petty, never give in. Except to convictions of honor and good sense, never give in. Then he sat down. Look at verse 1 of me this morning. The author writes, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, in this text here, he's likening the Christian life to athletic contests, a marathon race, which we are a part of. Believe it or not, we're in a race, and this race begins at the moment of salvation, and it ends when we go home to be the Lord. And this race is not a sprint, but it's a marathon. It's not run overnight, and so we must run with endurance. We must hang in there, and we must continue to run this race. But also what we see in verse 1, he says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Who are these witnesses? If you go back to chapter 11, verses 3 through 30, you'll see he lays out the hall of faith. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Enoch, Moses, Barak, David. He lays out all these people in chapter 11 who are good examples of persevering in faith. He says we have his witnesses watching us. They're cheering us on as we are running. I struggle as a father right now because my daughter wanted to play basketball. I didn't want to play for the longest. And then so I gave in. My wife told me, just let her play. Make sure we win. You never know. Just let her play. All right? And so I let her play. And I was like, oh, this girl can play a little bit. And I took her to the gym. And I said, one time I do this out because I thought she wasn't going to do it. I said, look, if you want to, some summer, because I'm a school teacher, I'm off doing summer. I said, if you really want to play, meet me at 6:30 in the morning. We'll go to the gym and work out. Do you not know, I was up in my room, I got knocked on the door. Yes? You ready? Daddy, you ready? Yes, I'm ready. Take it to the gym. We go, we work out, we work out, we work out, work out. Still, I was on the couch, work out, work out. Okay, all right, you're tired now, right? Good, let's go home. And I did it again, the next day, the next day, the next day, the next day, the next day. And I was like, okay, this girl's okay. She can play. I thought she was going to quit, but she can begin to play. And so now when she's playing these games, I'm in August cheering her on. And I got to say, I cannot live my dream through her, but I got to cheer her on. So when I'm at the games, I got to make sure I'm not coaching her either. Pass the ball this way. Go right. Go left. I got to watch because the coach, that's the coach's job to coach her. It's my job as a parent to cheer her on. And what he's saying is this, these crowd of witnesses, they are in here. They're watching us as we go on. They're saying, don't quit. Don't quit. Hang in there. Hang in there. Persevere. And he says, they're watching us. They're cheering us on. They're a fan. They're in the crowd now. They're watching us because they've had their time, and now they've moved on. So now it's their job. This is the next generation job to move forward. I got to say the same thing to my parent about the game. I'm not the coach. I'm just a parent. I'm supporting her. I'm here. I'm there. I got to support the coach. I'm here. And what the author Hebrews saying, these guys, they're watching you, cheering you on as you run the race. He says, you got to run with endurance. He says, run this race with endurance. I also think of when I went to Washington Bible College many years ago, and I played for the team. And certain nights we played our rival teams, Baptist Bible College, Valley Forge College, all these colleges. We had these major games to us. The alumni would be in the stands cheering us on. I didn't know all the alumni. I heard of them, but I didn't know who they were. But they're cheering us on, and they're jumping up and down. They have the coins in the water container, shaking it up, making all this noise in the gym. And I'm like, who are these people? I say, that's such-and-such. He graduated in 92. This such-and-such. He graduated in 84. Such-and-such here. And I realize that they don't know me or the others, but they are cheering for us because we're playing on a team they once played for. Now their job, they want to see us do well. They want us to finish the season well. They want us to finish the game well. And so we have the same thing with these witnesses. They want us to finish well. So that's where he is. He says, look, you got these great cloud of witnesses with you. Don't give up. David wanted to give up. Moses wanted to give up. When the people were grumbling against him, sure he wanted to give up. He would call them a bunch of rebels when he hit the rock. He says, no, hang in there. Hang in there. Here's the first point for this morning. Persevering in faith, how? Lose every unnecessary burden. Look at verse 1 again. He says, let us also lay aside every weight. What you have back in that day on the athletic contest, when the runners would run, they would have these long, heavy robes on, and they would walk out the road one. They cannot run the race with a long, heavy robe on. The robe would slow them down. They would trip up. They would fall as they're running a marathon race with a robe on. But the author of Hebrews saying, lay it aside. Take off this robe so you can run the race well. It reminds me some years ago when some people started wearing all these pads in football. Even now today, if you look at football players, they were on pads anymore. They had hip pads, they had thigh pads, they had knee pads, they had rib pads, all those. If you look at football, watch Ravens, you'll see they lost all these pads. And the reason why they lost all these pads is because the pads will slow them down. You got a helmet, you got shoulder pads, you have all this stuff, and you're trying to run, and you got all this equipment on, you're running slowly. But when you lose the pads, you can run faster. And what the author of Hebrews said, when you lose these unnecessary burdens in your life, you can run faster. Whatever's worrying you, whatever's distracting you, whatever the burden is, he says, lay it aside. Look at 1 Peter chapter 5. Peter says, cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. When you cast them upon the Lord, say, Lord, you have to deal with this. You have to take this. Guess what? You can say, I gave it to the Lord. Let's move on. Look at the second part of verse 1. And he says, and the sin which clings so closely. He says, first you got to lay aside unnecessary things, but he says, also the sins that so easily entangle you. The author of Hebrews doesn't mention a specific sin here. He doesn't say what it is. He doesn't outline anything, but he's making the assumption that whatever it is, whatever you're in, he says, you got to lose it because you can't run the race well. He says, it's holding you back. It's slowing you down. You got to lose it. You got to get rid of it because if you don't get rid of it, it will hold you back and you won't be able to do it. God is calling us this morning, whatever it is, lay it aside. Sometimes looking to the past, it's okay to look at the past and remember the past, but you hold on to the past so much you can't see what's before you. You're looking so much back to the past, you're holding on to, you're looking down, and you can't see what's in front of you. Sometimes it may be whatever's going on in your life that you're struggling with. He says, let it go so you can run this race well. I mean, you go down the list, you can say anger. We all have anger to some degree. You have gossiping, whatever we gossip to some degree. He says, whatever it may be, he says, let it go. He says, let it go so you can run this race that is set before you without distractions. He calls us to lose it. Here's the second point for this morning. First point is lose up every unnecessary burden. Here's the second point. It says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. In early chapters, he mentioned Enoch, he mentioned Abel, he mentioned Joseph, David, Barak, all these other great men of the faith. But he says, yes, these are great examples of the faith. They're great examples, but the ultimate example is found here in chapter 12 is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the star player. Jesus is the great franchise player of the church. He says, look to Christ. He says, because the church is built on Christ. He's the solid rock on which we stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. He says, look to Jesus. One commentator writes this. There could be an appropriate response to the appeal only in light of the struggle and the triumph of Christ. Christians are defined in Jesus, whose death on the cross displayed both faithfulness and endurance, the supreme example of persevering faith. His endurance of hostility from those who were blind to God's redemptive design and their own welfare provides a paradigm for the community of faith. Here's a key part. Whenever it encounters hostility from society. Why is it so important? Many times when things get rough and stop going to quit. I told you about my 1-8 season as a basketball coach. I wanted to quit. This looks bad on my coaching resume. It looks bad on my coaching resume. It looks bad. But you know what? It was good. I hung in there. I was able to encourage these young men. I was able to say, not only just in basketball, but in life, things don't always go your way. You get some wins. You get some losses. You get some tough losses. You get some humbling losses sometimes. But do you turn back? Turn your back on it? Do you quit? Do you walk away? Many times we look to everything else and everyone else but to Jesus. We look at Jesus. He had a 3.5-year ministry. He was born of a carpenter, and he came, and he wasn't here on earth in his ministry for 10, 20 years, only 3 years. And then he eventually died on the cross. And he didn't come down from the cross. People spat on him. People beat on him. And guess what? Is that success? He says, look to Jesus. He says, look to him. Many times in this world, we look to many different things. We look to alcohol. We look to having a good time. We look to this thing. We look to that thing. And we do all this stuff. And it's just a temporary fix. It helps for a moment. We forget about it for a moment. We pass out. And then after that, we still have to deal with it tomorrow. And he says, look to him. He's the author and perfecter of your faith. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the life sustainer and changer. He says, look to this man. He's been through a lot. There was a young man who had lost his grandfather. And his grandfather did everything to him. His grandfather taught him everything he knew. He loved his grandfather. But when his grandfather passed away, it rocked his world. It was tough. He wanted to give up. And I was watching this Bluefish video of his teaching with this young man. The young man said he got so bad and depressed, he began smoking marijuana. And every day his focus was, how much can he smoke and when can he smoke? And he said every time he smoked, he was hoping it would take away the pain that he was dealing with from losing his grandfather. Someone who taught him everything. But when he said he came down off his high, he still had to deal with the problem. The problem didn't go away. He still had to deal with his problem. And then the Lord stepped in. And the Lord began to change his perspective, his mindset. He began to look at the scriptures and realize that there is still hope. God brought your grandfather in your life for a reason, for a time as this, to help and work through you. But God wants you to look to him now, trust his son now to get through the tough times. We must look to Christ. We look at the movie Passion of Christ. We look in scriptures as you look at the Passion Week of Jesus Christ. As you read through the scriptures, he's mocked. He's beat up first the week before. I'm sorry, let me back up. You go to Palm Sunday saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They're celebrating him first, but then through Passion Week, they begin to back off. They begin to leave. And when the Romans guard took them, they were gone. Even Peter, the apostle, he denied him 3 times. This was a man who had courage. This was a man who would say, Lord, I would never deny you, deny Jesus. And as you look to Jesus, He hung in there, carrying his cross, being beat upon, being spat upon. I just imagine, I'm using my sanctified imagination, these are probably people that he healed. These are probably people that he fed. These are probably people who were following him and who were with him, and they were all in Jesus. But when it became hard, they said, no, we're not all in. We're out. You're talking some crazy stuff now, Jesus. We're out of this. But you see, Jesus went all the way to the cross to pay for our sins. He went all the way. He didn't give up on us. Look how often Hebrews describe Jesus. Look at verse 2 again. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. The author means basically he's the originator of our faith. We see this when Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, he prayed, God, Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. He was willing to trust the Father to death. The text goes on to say, and perfecter of faith. Jesus, he started our faith, but he's perfected our faith. He brought our faith into completion. In John chapter 19, verse 30, Jesus says, "It is finished." His work on the cross was done and completed. The text goes on. In verse 2, it says, "Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross?" He endured the cross when he suffered on his way to the cross. He kept his eye on Christ. Just think about this. He's here on earth. He's fully God. He's fully man. And in the human flesh, he's being beat upon. He's been punched in the face. He's been slapped. He's been hit with a whip. But he kept his eye on the prize. His eye was going to the cross to be crucified and be resurrected so other people could come behind him. Other runners would come behind him. He had his mind set on generations beyond him. That was the goal in the midst of being beat upon, being spat upon, being humiliated, being embarrassed. He says, "I'm going all the way to the cross because I'm doing this for generations to come." Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10, same book, it says, "For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things and through whom all things, in bringing many sons to glory." Not only Jesus endured the cross, verse 2 says, "Despising the shame." As I said earlier, it's the embarrassing thing to go to the cross. This was reserved for criminals. People were considered subhuman. Roman citizens were not allowed to go to the cross to die for the sins of the world. But Jesus, he despised all that. And he says, "I'm going because I'm doing this for other runners. I'm going all the way for other runners because this will affect generations to come." He didn't worry about that. Look at the last part. After he went through all that, after he went through the embarrassment, after he went through the shame, after he went through all the ridicule and having his clothes gambled among people, look at this, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. He's at the right hand of the throne of God, a position of power and authority. The story doesn't end on Good Friday. We thank God for Sunday morning because he got up from the grave with all power in his hands. He then fulfills what he told Lazarus in John chapter 11. "I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever believes in me will never die. Even though he dies, yet he will live." He says, "I am the resurrection and life." He's at the right hand of the Father. He's in a high place. We thank God for that. When in sports, I'm going to use sports illustrations because this thing in Hebrews is talking about running a race. You have the athletic metaphor here. And so when in sports, you have some great players in jerseys that retire. When they play well for the team, they retire their jerseys. College, pro, they retire their jerseys. They hang them up in the rafters of the arena. And these great players, they hang them up there because of what they accomplished on the floor. They did well. They played well. Rough times, good times, bad times, they played well. They endured until the end. One thing that's very inspiring to many athletes when they see these jerseys hanging in the arena. They get inspired when they see these breaks that went before them because as they walk on the floor now and they're playing the game and they see the greats that went before them and they're looking up in the rafters of the arena, they remember this person that went before. They remember that person that went before. They remember this person, this person, this person, this person. And as a result, they are encouraged to play the game. They are encouraged to represent the name of the team on the front of their jersey because they remember who went before them. Middle River Baptist Church, we have a great player that went before us. It's Jesus Christ. Yes, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are good, but Jesus is our ultimate example of persevering in the faith. He fought the good fight. He finished well, and now the encouragement for us is to finish it well. There are some difficult days, but God has still called us to be a light in the dark place. He still called us to finish well, to be encouraged when we don't feel like it. Jesus is that great player that went before us. As I close this morning, I have 2 points. The first one is losing every unnecessary burden. The second point was look to Jesus. I'm going to close right now. One of my favorite movies growing up was the movie Rocky. I love Rocky. If I had, this week, okay, I can do this week. I can watch part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, part 5. I can watch everything. I just love Rocky. I don't know how many times I've seen the movie. I just love Rocky. One of my favorite ones is Rocky IV. I love the part when he fights for his friend Apollo Creed. I love it because he goes away off to Russia. He has, he's not in the best conditions. He's running in the snow. He's working out this little random little place. He don't have all the sophisticated equipment, and he's training. And I love that movie so much. And one of my favorite parts of the movie is as he's training, and he's thinking about his friend, his manager or trainer would get his face, he would say, "No pain." He would get up in his face as he's training, he's sweating. I can imagine training. You're doing sit-ups and push-ups, your stomach hurts, you're lifting weights, you're carrying people, you're running, and he's like, "No pain." And I'm like, "Man, that's annoying." But as I begin to look at it, I'm like, he's training, because when Rocky will fight this Russian Ivan Drago, he'll get the best of Rocky. If you look at the first two rounds, I believe the first two rounds, I'm going to watch again. If you look at the first two rounds, he's punching him, he's hitting him, and Rocky's falling back, and back, and back, and back. And his manager gets in his face says, "No pain. No pain." And Rocky said, "No pain. No pain." This phrase simply means hang in there. Persevere. Even though you're getting beat up, even though the training's getting rough and tough, because the training is preparing you for the fight anyway, but when it gets rough and tough, you remember this saying, "No pain," because you remember to move forward, to hang in there. Middle River Baptist Church, as we go through these difficult days ahead of us, remember, no pain. No pain. God has not forgotten this place. God has not forgotten you. He's ordered your situation for a reason, and he wants us to look to him. So I just say to you this morning, you feel like giving up? No pain. You feel like quitting on the Christian life? No pain. You feel like doing to walk away? No pain. No pain. No pain. No pain. Keep moving forward. Persevere. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this church. We thank you for the people that you have here. And God, we just thank you for all you've done and all you're going to do. And we just ask that you have your hand and your grace and mercy upon us as we endure these difficult days ahead of us. We look to you, Lord, as we go along charted territories which we're not aware of. But Lord, we know you have it. It's all in your hand. So Lord God, we give you thanks for all you've done and all you're going to do. And we ask, Lord, that you help us persevere in the faith as we look to you, that great player, Jesus Christ. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, Pastor Lawrence will come forward.
Reverend Maurice, I want to thank you for that wonderful word, persevering in the faith. What a timely word that is for us this morning. Before we close, I just want to remind you all of a couple of things. The church office will be open this week, so if you have any prayer requests, any concerns, if you need something, please call us or come see us. We would love to talk with you. Also, I want to remind both the church council and the deacons that we are meeting tomorrow at 6 p.m. to discuss the way for us to move forward in this season. So let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, again, we thank you, Father, for your wonderful grace and your mercy, Lord. Lord, I thank you that you set before us such a great cloud of witnesses that we can see all those who have ran, Father, but most importantly, we can see your Son, Jesus, Lord, the author, the finisher of our faith, Lord. We can see the path that he ran, Lord, the standard that he set, and that we can walk and run with our eyes fixed upon him, Lord, to finish the race that you called us to run in, Father. Lord, and so I pray for all of us, we would lay off anything that is distracting us, anything that is holding us back, Lord, and that we would run with perseverance, Father, with endurance, Lord, with purpose, Father, with determination, Lord, understanding who you are, your goodness, your mercy, and your grace, Father. Lord, in this season of concern, Lord, about sickness, Lord, I pray, Lord, you would be with us. You would encourage us, Lord. You would comfort us, Father. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would put your protection over each one of us and our families, Lord. And I pray, Lord, you will give us wisdom in how to walk, how to move, Lord, how to understand, how to live in this season, Lord, in a way that is honoring to you, that is loving of those around us, Father, Lord, and that lives out the model and the purpose that you called us to live, Father. So, Lord, again, we thank you, Lord, and we ask that you bless us this week, Lord, and that you would be with us, Father. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Powerful.